What material do we produce over 400 million tons of annually? Take 50 to 500 years or more to naturally decompose and has been the cause of over a million marine animal deaths each and every year. If you guessed plastic, then you are a winner! Don't mind the blatant context clues from the title, description, clips, or... you know. The matter that took the world by storm, encapsulating just about everything that we use today. Even in its early days, plastics have been an utter nuisance without a clear solution for its waste management. We as consumers have been placed the sole responsibility of recycling it along with other paper and glass waste. The ad campaigns pushed throughout the 70s, 80s, 90s, and 2000s from both federal and Fortune 500 companies like Coca-Cola promised us that if we make sure all recyclable waste is, then we would never have to make another novel bottle again. Reduce, reuse, recycle, right? We can make a big change. Though, contrary to popular belief, less than 10% of all plastic ever made has actually been recycled. With an estimated 8 million tons of plastic entering our oceans each and every year, due to overfilling landfills across the board, it's even predicted that by 2050, there could be more plastic than fish in the ocean as a whole. Which, I don't know about you, but is a chilling fact to hear, seeing as that's less than 3 decades away. And also the same amount of time since the introduction of the PlayStation 2, not to mention George W. Bush. Ergo, not that long As a responsible member of society, one would hope we all do our due diligence to at least sort out the plastic, paper, and glass from the produce and shopping we do. From federal campaigns on TV and in schools, to packaging in stores urging consumers to recycle whenever we can. Recycling scheme, turning empty crisp packets into new useful things. With hundreds of collection points across the country, all you have to do is save your crisp packets, give them a clean, and take them to your nearest drop-off. Even the logo itself shows the continued cycle of using a material, then reusing it once again for repeated consumption. However, many studies argue otherwise, as research has put it up as high as 94% of all the plastics produced are single-use plastics. Even if you're lucky, most of the bottles and containers used in produce are usually recycled to nylon for clothing and fabric anyways. From certain plastic types not being able to be recycled altogether, to user error either during recycling or failure to properly clean out. This all leads to well over 90% of the recycling we sort out to be resorted out to landfills either in the States.
Sorry,
get out of here, you earth-hating, carbon-farting, unrecyclable garbage person. It's ruined.
Or across the pond in many developing countries. What doesn't get burned and infiltrate the atmosphere with toxic chemicals seeps into the ocean for our fish and other marine life to be severely impacted on a global scale. From animals entangled in debris, leading to injury or even death, to ingestion of these plastics causing internal damage and starvation. Plastic pollution through the disruption of natural cycles can even transport invasive species along with its harmful chemicals, desecrating ecosystems and potentially affecting human health through seafood contamination. Since even single-use plastic bags decompose into microplastics within a decade or two in salt water, when I say decompose, I don't mean it in the regular sense like organic produce. Due to the salinity of the water, the plastics break down into millions and millions of tiny microplastic particles, small enough for any fish or shrimp to ingest while breathing in seawater, with studies noting that more than 60% of the fish, crustacean, and other sea life we digest containing microplastics from pollution in our oceans. By 2025, a few studies even updating the percentage to 99% of all marine life having at least some microplastics in their systems. This seems like an impossible fight to win. The global production of plastic in 1950 was just 2 million tons. Today, well over 450 million tons annually, and rising. All of a sudden, in less than a generation's time, plastics have infiltrated literally everything we use and consume. Ever since its birth in 1909, no one has really known how to get rid of it.
And generating pollution in the process.
It may seem like plastics have been here forever, as many of us have never really known a world where plastic packaging and utility hasn't been the norm. Nevertheless, the reality is that half of all the plastics ever created in history were since 2005, making this issue a perilously compounding one. Making matters worse, a lot less plastic is recycled than you might think. Only around 8.7% of all produced plastics are really recycled, with the vast majority, around 79%, ending up in landfills and the ocean. The remaining 12%, which aren't kept in landfills, are incinerated, releasing millions upon millions of metric tons of greenhouse gases into our already brittle atmosphere. More so, depending on the state recycling laws, many of the packaging for produce meant to be recycled can't even be, either since the material itself can't be technically recycled or due to food contamination. With the average trash accumulation rate of 3,000 tons per day from a developed country, our global pre-designated landfill areas are projected to fill up by 2040, leaving only two other routes for plastic elimination: chipping away at our stratosphere or ending up in the ocean, where it breaks down into microplastics and gobbled up by fish, crustaceans, and many of the other underwater delicacies from around the world. For Christ's sake, even the organic sea salt that the bougies rave about is chock full of microplastics, where a study by the National Institute of Health reporting levels ranging from 1 to 1,674 particles per kilogram. No wonder the World Wildlife Fund even created a research group assessing plastic ingestion from nature to humans. A study performed by the group even estimated the average global person consumes a credit card's worth of microplastics every single week. That's 5 entire grams worth of plastic, taken in from water bottles, microwavable containers, and even the jugs our drinks come in. Now, not all plastics are made equally. As syndication of the material evolved, the Society of the Plastics Industry, or SPI, now known as the Plastics Industry Association, introduced in 1988, created a categorization system to better filter all the different plastics being made. The Resin Identification Code, or RIC, are a set of 7 categories designed to help identify the type of plastic resin used in a particular product, facilitating quote-unquote recycling by enabling proper sorting and
processing. If you've at the bottom of a disposable bottle or cup, you've probably noticed this symbol. Many people assume the item they're holding should be tossed in a recycling bin. Yet many of these plastics are incapable of being recycled at most centers. In fact, our recycling problem is multi-layered, beginning at production. These plastics gain stability through curing, a process that hardens a material by irreversibly cross-linking its molecular chains.
Ever think about these logos and your plastics before? Here's why you should. They tell you what kind of plastic a product is made from.
This code was presented as a way to help consumers and facilities sort their trash. Each number indicates the material the plastic is made of.
In fact, plastics number 1 and 2 are recycled significantly more than the other types, because there's someone willing to buy these types of recycled plastic and turn them into something else. Types 1 and 2 are used in products like water bottles, peanut butter jars, shampoo bottles, gallon jugs, and a lot of other things that are parts of our everyday lives. These plastics are more easily sorted and melted into pellets that can be sold to manufacturers. The other plastics are more difficult to recycle and turn back into raw material due to their chemical composition, coloring, or unusual shapes. For these reasons, there's not a large market to recycle these plastics today.
Known as its resin, some resin numbers are recyclable at most centers, while others are not. And yet within this system, all numbers are surrounded by the universally recognized recycling symbol, misleading consumers into thinking that many unsalvageable plastics have a chance at a second life.
Of these 7 types of commonly believed recyclable plastics, very few are actually being recycled, with only most of number 1 and 2 being reused post-waste, though depending on the state, many that have touched produce may still end up in a landfill regardless. Out of the other 5 subsets, 4, 6, and 7 being a bulk of all the plastic being produced in modern day, used for cups, bags, and even pouches for drinks and snacks, we're only able to recycle less than 5% of that in 2020. Either due to the mixture of complex resins for certain types, making it nearly impossible to successfully recycle the materials, or more practical reasons like difficulties of sorting or cleanliness being an issue, more than 90% of all the plastic supposedly being recycled isn't. Like always, to exacerbate matters, with there sometimes being no market for some greener alternatives, and the fact that it's literally cheaper to make more new plastic than it is to recycle used ones, the problem seems to be only getting worse. Even though these heavy plastic corporations knew that most of the productions weren't able to be recycled, they still pushed heavily through lobbying lawmakers to mandate all plastic being produced to include their subsequent irrelevant categories. At the same time, tossing money at anti-littering campaigns across the globe to further hammer in the presumed consumer responsibility of limiting plastic pollution, and not the companies producing the hundreds of millions of tons of plastic each and every year. Now, I will give it, we all have that one friend who never recycles and could care less about the future of our shared planet. First of all, snip snip. Secondly, though the lack of recycling knowledge in today's first world countries, even after massive campaigns in the 90s and 2000s, does add on to this massive disaster of an execution. With there being hundreds of thousands of items tossed into our recycling plants each and every day, either not being cleaned out properly or never being a reusable item in the first place, the term wishcycling was coined to further pressure this narrative. Wishcycling incorporates all the items you wish was recyclable. Okay, but an umbrella is freaking crazy, like, bro. Wishcycling not only adds to the number of items not being recycled, it clogs up recycling plants and only adds to the amount of time needed to process everything coming in. But this isn't a novel ordeal. The issues of plastics have been looming on the heads of society ever since the start to its massive global production. We just haven't really worried about it until around the pandemic. Since prior to their ban, China was receiving around 70% of the world's plastic waste to support its manufacturing industry. However, they have since banned the shipment of plastic waste from all countries, leaving much of the developed world to rely on Southeast Asian countries like Malaysia or Cambodia, who, with much smaller infrastructure for manufacturing, cannot handle such burdens of hundreds of millions of tons of plastic, ending with the inevitable. Burning of this waste as landfills overflood with new arriving shipments. In a few decades, it might not just be the ocean that's more than halfway filled with plastic. How did humanity get itself into this kind of mess? Today, we know plastic as the man-made material responsible for placing our individual hormonal systems into unknown chaos, polluting our fresh and saltwater resources, ravaging countless ecosystems and species across the globe, and also making grocery trips a freaking breeze. All in all, a net negative in the books of our planet, as well as generally unnatural. However, the concept plastics derive its structure from is in every living organism that we have come to know. Nature has been knitting polymers since the beginning of life itself. The proteins in our muscles and skin are polymers, along with the cellulose that make up plant cell walls. Even the long spiraling ladders that hold the structure to our genetics are polymers. The only difference, and the cause of much of the troubles we now face decades later, are that plastics contain synthetic polymers, not organic. And no, this isn't just a war between Whole Foods and Trader Joe's. Before the invention of synthetic plastics, plant cellulose was the raw material used primarily to make earlier plastics. However, with the financial incentives looming ever since 1909, synthetic plastic is and has been the smarter alternative, regardless of the environmental and health detriments that may arise from its corporate abuse.
But is that true? Or are we just going to end up getting burned?
Clearly, as we have finally begun seeing the long-term effects that ingesting microplastics can do to the human body, from hormonal imbalances to increased risk for cancers among other diseases, the ever-evolving predicament of plastics has not faltered. The invention of Bakelite in 1907 marked the first fully synthetic plastic by Leo Hendrik Bakelite.
Bakelite, the very first plastic.
In Yonkers, New York. Before this, there were many whom attempted to process semi-synthetic versions of plastic. It's the latest thing, it's all the rage. Alexander Park's creation of Parkinzine in 1856, combining cellulose with nitric acid and alcohol in substitute of ivory, to John Wesley Hyatt, improving upon this theory by adding camphor to the mix and creating celluloid, which was all the rave for billiard lovers and film connoisseurs alike. Bakelite was different. Unlike the celluloid bases of the previous, relying on plant polymers, Bakeland was able to create fully synthetic polymers through the mixing of phenol and formaldehyde. Then modern synthetic plastics were born, and corporations took hold like moths to flame. Bakeland announced his discovery at the 1909 meeting of the American Chemical Society 2 years later. From there, word took off across the globe of the first fully synthetic plastic material with the ability to propel mankind and consumerism to unproportioned heights. Though mass production globally didn't take off until the 1940s and 50s, when driven by factors like World War II and advancements in molding technology, the material skyrocketed with the backing of Industrial Revolution factories and permeated literally every single industry known to man.
Why do B2B videos always have people in a conference room with generic charts and someone writing on a whiteboard? Hey Lou, what you writing?
I have no idea.
Using Bakelite as the building block for further research and development in the decades following, the conclusion of vast array of synthetic polymers with diverse properties and uses, transforming numerous industries and shaping modern society as we know it. Today, many green supporters even now introduce the plant cellulose plastic route as a new substitute for the once synthetic alternative. Wow. Don't you just love it when you waste your own time?
This is the shit that I do for science, literally.
It seems like society has finally begun at least attempting to backtrack on the unfortunate timeline of events from the previous century. Though, we better get on that with breakneck speed, I might add, as modern industry and life itself relies just as much on this material as our natural environment relies on us stopping its production. The tug of war between ease and lifestyle and the inevitable destruction of our planet is ever convoluted, to say the least. With the speed of produce sales and consumer dependence, and plastic's ability to keep foods amongst other goods fresh and edible, there isn't a single non-synthetic resource that can take the heavy burden of plastics. With any plant polymer alternative, within a short amount of time, we would either run out of that material or be forced to transition to other alternatives, impacting product reliability and subsequently increasing market and economic volatility. Therefore, this issue definitely isn't as simple as, let's just stop making plastics. With other more reusable materials also being far more expensive to produce, in some industries where we've seen alternative replacements, that discrepancy is then placed onto the consumer with higher prices chalked up to increasing material costs. At this point, it isn't just our job to recycle, but to pay up for companies to not destroy the environment while also paying for that product or service. Since we're already paying to rent out tools, homes, and houses, what's another $50 a month paid out as an environmental tax? And please, for the love of God, don't let that sarcasm slip you.
The plastic problem has created one of the biggest environmental threats to our planet.
Are your thumbs coming up?
I just want to go get it.
Ugh, stop it. Get some help.
Okay, say you're not ready.
I can just tell what I see though. Swerving through this, I am limitless.